Good morning and welcome. Welcome to Immanuel Lutheran Church on this Baptism of Our Lord Sunday, where we hear of Jesus' baptism and the Spirit of God coming upon him and proclaiming him God's beloved child with whom God is well pleased. Just as at our baptism, the Spirit of God comes upon us and names us God's beloved child. A special welcome to any guests that we have with us this morning. We are glad that you are joining us here on this online format for worship. Our conviction that God has made us all unique and valuable means that we welcome you. We welcome you to bring your whole self with your own perspectives, abilities, ethnicity, gender identity, sexual orientation, and cultural background to this community where all belong and have a purpose. At Immanuel Lutheran Church, we are a community through whom God is transforming lives by sharing our faith in God's love and grace. Let us take a moment of silence to prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Lord, prepare us to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving we'll be all living sanctuary for you.
Blessed be God, the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light and our salvation. Amen. Amen. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism.
We give you thanks, O God, the living one. For you have created all, and you water the earth abundantly. Oceans and aquifers praise you. Rivers and streams bless you.
All life is sustained by you, our source. We praise you for Christ, the firstborn from the dead, who frees us from sin and raises us up to new life. Here at this font, we touch the river of the water of life. Bright as crystal, flowing through the city of God. Here, death is washed away forever. Here, we are grafted into the tree of life with leaves for the healing of the whole world.
Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, into the community around us, and throughout all creation. Cleanse us from our fears, and drown us from divisions. Grant that all may drink of your mercy and peace, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
God, creator of light and giver of goodness, your voice moves over the waters. Immerse us in your grace and transform us by your Spirit, that we may follow your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The first reading is from Genesis, the first chapter. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
The Littlest Angel by Charles Taswell, a book written in 1946. Once upon a time, a cherub known as the Littlest Angel came into paradise. He was exactly 4 years, 6 months, 5 days, 7 hours, and 42 minutes old when he came to the kingdom of God. The Littlest Angel pretended that he wasn't afraid, but his lower lip trembled and a tear ran down his cheek. In heaven, the Littlest Angel's halo was always slipping down, sometimes over his right eye or his left eye, or down some golden street. One day, the littlest angel was called before the understanding angel. The littlest angel combed his hair, he put on clean clothes, then he slowly walked to the place of judgment. The littlest angel told how hard it was for a boy who suddenly becomes an angel. There wasn't anything for a small angel to do. The understanding angel asked what would make him happy. The cherub thought for a moment, then whispered, "There's a box I left under my bed. If only I could have that, I would be content." "You shall have it," promised the understanding angel. When the littlest angel received his box, he turned into the most happy angel in paradise. Then it came to pass that Jesus, the Son of God, was to be born. What could the littlest angel give to the Son of God? He had only one thing to give, but he loved it more than anything. On the day of the miracle, the littlest angel proudly placed his small box before the throne of God. The littlest angel trembled as the box was opened. There was a butterfly with golden wings, a sky blue egg from a bird's nest, two white stones from a riverbank, and a strap from the collar of his dog. The voice of God spoke, "Of all the gifts, this small box pleases me most. I accept this gift in the name of the child." Jesus was born that night in Bethlehem. The box began to glow. It rose until it hung over the stable where the Son of God had just been born. The box would forever be known as the Shining Star of Bethlehem.
The Holy Gospel, according to Mark, the first chapter. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove upon him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. The Gospel of our Lord. Let us open with the word of prayer. Good and gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Who are you? This question of identity is an important question for all of us. And when I answer that question for myself, I start to think, I am a pastor. I'm a person of faith. I'm a Lutheran Christian. I'm a daughter, an aunt, a little sister, a friend. I'm a person who cares and works toward ending homelessness and other injustices in the world. When I answer for myself the question, who am I find that my answer is all about relationships. I seem to be who I am because of my relationships. Because of the loyalties and allegiances that I have in my life. And so for me, the question isn't just who am I, but it's actually whose am I? And what about you? Do you find that too, that when you answer that question, who am I, it leads you to relationship and it leads you further to whose am I? To what do I remain loyal, give my allegiance? This is not just a question for us as individuals. This is a question for us as a nation and as communities. And this week, as our nation's capital was attacked by a violent mob, we asked ourselves that question, who are we and whose are we as a nation? And too many of us were surprised and asked the question, how did we get here? I heard people ask that question. Isn't this something that happens in other countries? Violent insurrections? Death from pandemics? Attacks on our soil? When these things happen in the United States of America, we somehow think they shouldn't happen here because we, after all, must be the most powerful and wealthiest and most just and most democratic country. We have given in to the myth of American exceptionalism, that we are somehow exceptional, the best and the perfect and the most valuable nation, rather than striving to be a good nation among many good nations, a nation that has both its strengths and its weaknesses. And some of us are not surprised that this happened. When we look at our history, we see that our nation was founded on the values of truth and justice and liberty for all. And when it was written, it was assumed that all meant white male landowners. And so people of African descent who were slaves had to strive and fight for their freedom. People who are Black had to strive and fight for their right to voice and vote. People who were women had to strive and fight for their right to voice and vote. People who are Native American had to strive for their right to live and to have land. People in the LGBTQ community had to strive and fight for their right to live and to have community. People, this summer, have striven to enact their right to protest. Some of those groups tried to protest very peacefully, and yet our lawmakers and our law enforcers geared up in riot gear and launched tear gas and bullets into the crowds, and it became more and more and more violent. And we would not wish that violence on anyone, but it is so readily apparent, the disproportionate response that we saw on Wednesday when we knew that someone had called people to come and protest with all they had against the people's democratic election and choice, and to get it overturned. The police and the law enforcers and the lawmakers were not prepared, and they stepped aside. And it led to deaths of police officers and others, deaths that are not okay or acceptable. We ask ourselves how we got here. It started from the beginning, but in more recent years, it has continued. I think to the early 2000s, when our nation was attacked and our nation responded, and some people agreed with our nation's response and some people didn't agree with our nation's response. And if you didn't agree with what our nation was doing at the time, you were called and labeled unpatriotic and disloyal. And patriotism and loyalty then became the highest value. In fact, it became so valuable and so important that if you were a perceived threat, if you were against us, if you were not with us, you were against us. If you were a perceived threat, then you were expendable. If you were foreign, you were expendable. And this patriotism got paired with another extremism, and that was extreme Christianity. The Christian perspective that said that if you do not believe in Jesus Christ the way that we do, then you are against us. And if you are against us, again, you are expendable. So people of other faiths, you are expendable. People who are immigrants, foreigners to this country, when you come here, you are so expendable that it is okay to cage you and to separate you from your children. People of color, you are not a white Christian nationalist. Your rights do not matter. Your votes don't have to count. And your lives are expendable. And when you get shot on the streets for walking down the streets or chased down and accused, we don't have to hold people accountable because your lives are expendable. Christian nationalism is dangerous. It leads to violence. It leads to a division between who is in and who is out, who is expendable and who is of value. And that circle of those who are in becomes smaller and smaller and smaller. And quite frankly, more and more violent. And this Christian nationalism over the last several years has been transferred so that not only are people flying the American flag and flying the Confederate flag that reminds us and seems to condone the history in our nation of slavery, but people have given their allegiance and their loyalty to now a person. And when allegiance and loyalty are given to a person, that person's call to action, that person's rhetoric, that person's will becomes the test of loyalty. And if you are not in agreement with that person, you must be disloyal and outside of the group and expendable. That is how we get Jonestown and Waco and Wednesday in the Capitol that leads to violence and to death. That leads to people replacing the American flag on the steps of the Capitol with a Trump flag, with the flag of a person, with a flag that says that I give my loyalty and my allegiance to this person above the nation, above humanity and creation, above my loyalty to Christ and to my Christian faith. It is dangerous. This Christian nationalism threatens to overtake all of Christianity, to be the only voice that is heard, a violent form of Christianity. So what do those of us who do not proclaim Christian nationalism do? What is our identity? How do we live it? How do we teach it? How do we live it? How do we enact it? How do we participate in the forming of our nation and our communities? Today we hear the story of the baptism of Jesus at the River Jordan. John, who knows his place and knows he is not the all in all, He points to Christ. John baptizes him, and three things happen. John baptizes him for repentance, for the forgiveness of sin. Jesus unites himself with all of humanity in the recognition that we humans are not perfect or exceptional. We strive to be good. We strive to live out the values of God, and we need forgiveness when we fall short, and we do. And so we are invited to be leading the way to critique our nation when we fall short, our communities when we fall short, ourselves when we fall short, to lay it at the foot of the cross and to know that God washes us clean in baptism to do and be better and good. Then when Jesus is baptized, he comes up out of the waters, the Spirit of God descends upon him and remains within him. This happens to us in our baptism as well. Not only are we forgiven and washed clean, but the Spirit of God comes within us and lives within us. And this Spirit actually immediately drives Jesus into the wilderness, and his identity is tested. His identity is tested. And the tester says to him, well, proclaim ultimate authority for yourself. And Jesus, who is the only one of us who could actually do so, says, no. My allegiance and my loyalty is to God and God alone. Because the third thing that happens at his baptism is that the voice from heaven proclaims to Jesus himself his identity, who he is. You are my beloved son. With you I am well pleased. It is the same proclamation that is given to us in our baptism. You are my beloved child, the child of God. And with you God is well pleased. We are not God. We are not the all in all. We are not the ultimate authority. We are God's child. And our allegiance and our loyalty is to God. Jesus was the full embodiment of the reign of God here on earth. And what he calls us to is to not proper, correct intellectual beliefs, but to a way of life, a way of being that is formed by the values of God, the values of life and love, and justice and community and healing. And Jesus is not one of violence. Those who claim violence in the name of Christ do great disservice to the message of God and great damage to the message of Christ. They distort it. Because Jesus is the one who takes the violence of the empire upon his own body on the cross. Because he is also not just not violent, but he is also not silent. Because silence is its own form of violence. And so he stands up for justice. And he teaches, and he proclaims, and he heals. And he calls out any injustice that he sees. And he does so through active, peaceful resistance. So when we are called to put our identity in our baptismal identity, to claim our baptismal identity and follow the way of Christ, we are called to not be violent, to not be silent, and to be bold in word and deed that brings forth the reign of God, built on the values of justice, love, and peace for all of God's creation, and all means all. That is the identity that we have inherited. And we can be silent no longer. And we need to exercise our voice. And so, I call us to join with others in this open letter to the Vice President Pence, members of Congress, and the Cabinet calling for the removal of President Trump from office. It is far past time. We cannot be silent any longer. And here is the letter. Our faith instructs us to take seriously positions of leadership, not to lead others astray, and to be careful about what we say and do. In Philippians 2:3-4, we are taught to do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. President Donald J. Trump's actions and words have endangered the security of the country and its institutions of government by inciting a violent, deadly, seditious mob attack at the U.S. Capitol. His words and actions have placed the lives of the people he is supposed to serve in great danger and to advance his own interests. Further, he not only failed to stop or condemn the attack after the Capitol had been stormed, but instead encouraged the mob by calling them patriots. This domestic terrorist attack resulted in at least 5 deaths, including a Capitol police officer and more than a dozen police officers injured. The desecration of the Capitol building was also disgraceful and reprehensible. For the good of the nation, so that we might end the current horror and prepare the way for binding up the nation's wounds, we as leaders of the members' communions of the National Council of Churches of Christ in the USA believe the time has come for the President of the United States, Donald J. Trump, to resign his position immediately. If he is unwilling to resign, we urge you to exercise the options provided by our democratic system. In addition, we recognize the need to hold responsible not only those who invaded the Capitol, but also those who supported and or protected and promoted the president's false claims about the election or made their own false accusations. We grieve for our country at this difficult time and continue to pray for the safety and security and ultimately the healing of our nation. Holding those who abused their power and participated in these immoral and tragic actions accountable, in particular, the President of the United States, is one step toward healing. Signed by the General Secretary and President of the National Council of Churches, the presidents and leaders and bishops of the United Church of Christ, the AME Zion Church, the Methodist Church, our very own Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, the ELCA, the Disciples of Christ, the Reformed Church, the Armenian Church, the Episcopal Church, Baptist churches, the Ecumenical Catholic Communion, the Presbyterian Church, and others. This is being sent out to you, a link to this letter that you can sign on to so that we can actively demand justice, that we can stand against oppression and Christian nationalism that has led to violence in our capital. Beloved children of God, in this time of Epiphany, let us claim our identity as those who follow the way of Christ, as baptized Christians. And as Lutheran Christians, let us lean in to our Lutheran perspectives and theologies that inform who we are and how we live and how we build community. And so we will be doing that in the month to come. And we will be reviewing our Lutheran theology that makes us, that helps us form the values that live into who we are as baptized people of God. May we work together from all different perspectives to heal our nation, to find our common core values and to live into them. And may we as Lutheran Christians be guided by our identity as beloved children of God, following the way of Christ to bring justice, peace, and love to all of God's good creation. And now may the peace of Christ, which surpasses all human understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in this same Christ Jesus, now and always. Amen.
Guided by Christ, let us offer prayers for the church, the world, and all in need. For the church throughout the world and its leaders, that guided by the Holy Spirit, they proclaim the forgiveness of sins, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For wilderness and water, wind and wild beasts, and all living things on earth, that God's goodness is revealed through creation and faithful stewards care for all God has made. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For the nations of the world and their leaders, for laborers both day and night, and for peacemakers amid strife, that God inspire all people to use their strength wisely. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For the sick and those who provide medical care, for the imprisoned and those who show them mercy, for the lonely and those who provide companionship, for all who suffer, that God shower compassion and bring healing. We pray especially for those on our prayer list: John, Diane, Ken, Jill, Angela, Gloria, Ralph, Dawn, Jackson, Betty, Sandy, Lori, Randy, Danny, Heidi, John, Kasia, Mike, Corpo, and the family and friends of Fernando, Dick, and Dave. And for what else do the people of God pray?
For Amy.
For Belinda.
For all our teachers and students and families and the schools. For all those suffering from COVID and those who have lost loved ones. For our nation to come together and to move past divisions and differences and move toward unity and justice and peace. For all people of all backgrounds, creeds, cultures, and colors.
Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For this community of faith, for students returning to school, for those seeking renewal in their daily work, for our guests of the satellite overflow shelter, that all the beloved of God experience grace and peace, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the sign of the water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so, with all the choirs of angels and the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal those who are sick and suffering, who preached good news to those who are poor, and who, on the cross, opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, Christ's life, death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share in this heavenly food, the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Beloved children of God, we are bold this morning to pray that risky prayer that Christ first taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We recognize that ideally we would experience and receive Holy Communion in community with one another. But we also recognize that the Spirit of Christ comes upon us and unites us as one body of Christ wherever we find ourselves. And so if you so choose, you are welcome to set out your own altar table at your house and to join us for communion this day. Receiving the bread of life, this is the body of Christ given for you. Receiving the cup of life, this is the blood of Christ given for you. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and keep you in God's grace. Amen.
In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus.
God's blessing. May God the Creator strengthen you, Jesus the Beloved fill you, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter keep you in peace now and always. Amen. Go in peace. Share the presence of Christ with all the world.
Thanks be to God.
A brief time of announcements. Thank you so much for everyone who contributed to worship today. Your gifts are such a joy to allow us to worship together. And a special thank you to those who are guests with us for the first time especially. We invite you to find our information and to reach out to us so that we can reach back to you and we can get to know one another better. Again, it is good to have you with us. As for events and opportunities for the week, today immediately following worship about 10:30 a.m., we do have our fellowship time online through our Zoom link. If you do not have the Zoom link or that phone number, then please contact me and let me know, and I will make sure to get that to you. Tomorrow, on Monday at 12:30 p.m., we have book study online, and that is through the same Zoom link. And that is going to be The Days of Awe and Wonder by Marcus Borg, chapter 7 and 8 we will be discussing this week. Bible study is Tuesday evening at 6:30 p.m. online. And you can find those readings in our weekly news. If you don't have it, email me and I can let you know what those are. Are there any other announcements that I forgot? Oh, the satellite overflow shelter continues to offer safe space and safe sleeps for at least up to 15 people in a very safe way here at the church. And so thank you to everyone who contributes to that ministry, providing meals, donating finances for supplies, or donating supplies. In the newsletter and information, you can find what is needed. In the weekly news, you will find the link to sign up on Sign Up Genius for providing a meal. And if you have any questions, you can always contact me, Pastor Adrian, and I would be happy to connect you with an opportunity to serve. Thank you for all your support. Are there any other announcements? I think that's all for this week, so have a blessed week. And remember, you are a beloved child of God. With you, God is well pleased. And God is using all of us to make a difference in this world. Amen.